Digitalization is transforming economies and governments, and technology can be a tremendous tool to make rapid progress. But what does a digital society look like in reality, and what are its impacts on people's lives? In this session, Martin Bruckno will interview Kersti Kaljulaid, the president of Estonia, on how digital societies can be an ally for advancing equality and equity, and for addressing global challenges such as sustainability and climate change.
Welcome, everyone. I'm extremely honored to welcome here with us today Her Excellency, the President of Estonia, Kersti Kaljulaid. Madam President, when I think of Estonia, the first thing that comes to mind is Skype, and then Bolt, and then TransferWise. These are some of the most successful digital unicorns in Europe. Estonia was, of course, also a pioneer of e-government, and more recently of e-citizenship. So this just shows very clearly that Estonia has arguably been the most successful country, or at least one of the most successful countries in Europe, in terms of having gone from a relative economic laggard to one of Europe's digital leaders. And what's really exciting is that you have been part of this story from the very beginning as an economic advisor to the then prime minister in the late 1990s. Now, would you tell us what's the secret of success here that other countries may be able to follow and learn from Estonia?
Yes, and interestingly, the answer is not at all related to technology. Estonian society does not separate into private and public sector. People who are always in the private sector, people who are always in the public sector. And as we know, at the turn of the century, I mean, you had online banking, most bigger companies had intranet models and systems. And when Linnar Viik, the digital advisor to Prime Minister Laar, and me coming from a bank, moved to the Prime Minister's office, we really didn't understand why on earth in public sector we are not taking advantage of these technologies. So we took as simple as that. Ma ei tea, mina ei kuule neid enam.
Hello, hello, can we hear each other?
I can't hear you.
Do we hear each other?
Now I can hear you again. I didn't hear you.
Oh, excellent. So now that you hear me, excellent. So, I mean, this
is
really fascinating. Sorry. So this is fascinating, and I'm sure that this digital technology and e-government must have somehow also helped in terms of advancing equality and equity in Estonia. Is that the case? And if so, can you give us a few examples how these technologies can actually really make a difference here?
Well, first of all, if all the services which we need in our life, which relate to the government, are online, then they are not available only from 9 to 5 and possibly also with the lunch break. So since it is mostly, unfortunately, women who apply for school places, for kindergarten places, for social services, all this is normally women who administrate these kind of work. This can be done in Estonia in the evening when your children are in bed. Also, because you have all these services online, women who process the other end, who offer these services, they are also less linked to geography and time. And I believe that this coronavirus crisis, which now has shaken loose all our economies, has made the rest of the world also to realize that 30% of the jobs at least can be done wherever and whenever. And it was possible already for at least 10 years. Simply, companies, enterprises failed to recognize that this is the case. Now they have had to do it. And this gives women tremendous opportunities to, for example, match your working life and your home life when you have small children. Because if you can work from home and if you can work while your child is very small, you are not watching on maternity leave how your classmates and university mates are getting their first places as heads of units and directors. Just one example.
That's fascinating. If I may move to a slightly different topic, and that's global warming. I mean, clearly, once we have resolved this corona crisis, this is going to be and remain a number one challenge for our societies for the coming decades. So where do you actually see the role of digital technologies and digital government in terms of accelerating this transition to carbon neutral economy and society? And is that, in fact, is there a role for the digital, or do we just need to put more money into science, or is the problem somewhere else? What should we be really focusing on?
Well, definitely there is space for not only digital technologies, but what we already have as digital technologies can hugely help us. For example, here in Estonia, we have smart grid, electricity grid, which means that each and every, well, every owner of a house or a flat, they can watch how much electricity they have been using in real time. And this means that in principle, we can guide through apps, of course, nobody's going to do this manually, the peak consumption. And we calculate that we can shift 20% of the peak consumption off, which means that you need 20% of a less of generation capacity. Huge saving, in fact. On Nord Pool, you can already trade today with electricity saved, electricity which was not used during the peak times. So this is one example. The other example is that when we think of the goods market, then nowadays we shift quite a lot of goods around global. If you separate production into design and engineering, which is actually a service, not a good, you can offer this from wherever globally. This also is a well, great advantage, a global services market to design my shoes or to design an airplane part. And then you simply need to find the closest plant which can print these things out. This is already happening, was already happening before the corona crisis and the trade difficulties, because regionalization of production was already ongoing.
So many countries are trying to build these smart grids. How did you actually achieve it in Estonia? Was this government driven? Was it private sector driven? Was it a combination of the two?
Actually, our grids are owned partially by private sector, some grids, local grids, and some are owned by a state managed company. So it was a joint effort also from the citizens' side to make sure that everybody is on board. Unfortunately, we see that since we are a nation of 1 million, I mean, we are not an interesting market. So the app development has been slow. So anybody who wants to try out the system for developing applications on smart grid, then please welcome to Estonia. I am quite sure that a few unicorns, well, we can fit in.
Yeah, well, I'm sure this has also been a blessing in disguise, because since you're a small market, your entrepreneurs have always focused on Europe as a whole and have been phenomenally successful in that. I mean, speaking of cooperation, I hope I'm not revealing any secret here when I say that you're now running for the Secretary General of the OECD, which is very exciting. And I believe this would also make you the first female Secretary General of the OECD, which would make it even more exciting. Now, this sort of multilateralism hasn't really been much in fashion, arguably, over the past few years. So, you know, where do you see a role for quote-unquote old-fashioned organization like the OECD in today's world, and particularly given these challenges, you know, whether it's digitalization, climate change, and I'm not even going to go into the political and geopolitical challenges?
OECD's strongest element is its ability to analyze and understand the trends, make them visible by calculating. So for example, if we notice that our services market is going global, you need to understand, I mean, how many people who have moved to independent working are actually digital nomads? How many people who work on our market provide their services globally from third countries? And based on this analysis, OECD can now make policy suggestions on how to, for example, make sure that those people who work in five different countries at the same time can easily pay their taxes, choose their, well, safe dock where they pay taxes and how to get services. Another example, in climate change, we are seeing that the European Union, but also other markets who are responsible, they are executing market distortions, which should lead us to creating the space for green technologies. Somebody needs to analyze these market distortions, whether they are protectionism in disguise, whether they are working, whether they are I mean, put in place with good intentions, but simply not failing. Another clear example. Third, technology is changing all our education mechanisms and systems. Our children learn technology as they go, but they are actually missing out on social skills. They also know different things compared to us when we went to school. Their knowledge base is not a function of age, but age and internet access and interests. How to teach such a generation so that they are not bored in the school, but they would also gain the necessary skills of being a compassionate human being. We need not only to measure in PISA the level of knowledge of children, but also the variations in this knowledge, for example. Again, to expose the trend which we all know exists, and based on this trend analysis, member states can choose how to react for the better policies for better future.
It's a fascinating vision, and we all hope you'll get an opportunity to put it into practice. Unfortunately, for the moment, we're out of time, so we will have to say goodbye. But thank you so much, Madam President, for joining us. Best of luck in your future endeavors, and thank you, everybody else, for viewing, and have a good rest of the day. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.